Most people in life are looking at how do I make a life worth living and retirement worth having. The amazing thing about people today is that they really think it's okay for them to take from the God's house. When they try to take from God's house, they usually wait for a moment when someone is not paying attention, when someone is over-focused and working in their computer or on their cell phone, and they literally steal from them. When I look at those people and I really think about this, I think, are they really that daft about God? You see, to be smart about the Lord is to know that God pays attention to all people, whether you have a faith or not. To be dumb about God is to say that there is no God and you are God in your own kingdom, your own majesty-ship, if you will. What I find about people who are arrogant is that they always want to be a pill in someone's life. They are so monstrously out of control in their own immature behavior that they never stop thinking to think about what God thinks of their life. You see, at some point we all have a demise. We either age ourselves out with cellular degeneration, which happens to every human being, every living thing, every plant even, and yet there are people who never think about the afterlife. They never think about standing before the Jesus that they claim to know and love to say what they need to say, to be an account and responsible for their life. You see, when we pretend like we have no responsibilities to anyone in life, people usually get harmed. It usually means you have stolen something from someone, you have taken rights from someone, or you're trying to harm someone out of your own internal struggle, your own ill will, or your own, well, possibly grief. You say you can grieve someone who's still alive for the longest time and it never subsides. You can also grieve a process of transition that is not yours, and that is your own lie. You see, your life is your life, but if you choose to lie, steal, cheat, or do anything involved with the Old Testament's Ten Commandments, you might be facing hell. And hell is not a place you want to be, because hell is an absence of beauty and absence of God. Long ago, there was a 1980s or late 1970s film that starred Julia Roberts and Kiefer Sutherland and a whole bunch of other people who were not exactly fully famous, but they were on their way to fame and claimed to fame, if you will. And basically, it was about the afterlife, and it talked marvelously about how people died and what their life was like in the real world and in their beliefs and in their systems created their, basically, heaven, not earth. There's been other films that have also kind of talked about that. Patch Adams might have been the other one, but I'm struggling with the one that Robin Williams within was, which was sort of marvelous and sort of all over the place in its creative lore. But at the same time, there was another film that was a marvelous film with Al Brooks, who's not in a lot of films, and Meryl Streep, which was a really marvelous film. And I'm struggling a little bit with the name, but it might have been Dying to Get In or something like that. But it was really marvelous in that he had to go through his life with her as his guide, walking towards heaven, basically. He had just died, and he had to walk through his life, the mistakes he made, the selfish choices he did, and he had to see what happened to the people that he literally harmed in his life. It was something along those lines. It might have even been written by him, but I don't recall at this time. I may post it at some point, but that's not the point. The point is, where you go in the afterlife will have an impact on your, well, afterlife. How you live your life today does have an impact on other people's lives. And when you lie to yourself about your rights to people that you have lost rights to, it's really hard. In my case, I've lost two very significant people in my life. Not on my purpose, not on anything I did to try to harm them, but on things they did to my life. And I'm sad about that. I struggle with that. I miss those soul strings. I miss those attachments. But I don't go out of my way to be dwelling on it every day. I certainly feel the longing, I certainly feel the missed opportunities with them, and I see the missed relationships that should have been right and not full of sin. But when it comes to siblings or other relatives who have decided to sin against me, to harm me and other things, I don't feel that morbid loss. What I feel is, you made a choice to betray, you made a choice to harm, you made a choice to molest, you made a choice to not use any of God's charm that He gifted you, and openly that's on your life. There are some things that people do to you that you cannot repair, you cannot come back for. there are other people who lie about what they do to people, and then they harm the people that they hit or they hurt because it's easier for them to get out of their own and shrug their own responsibilities. You see, a mature person who loves God or the Lord or whatever your faith practice and spirituality is knows that there is a responsibility. There's a responsibility for our own selfish desires, there's a responsibility for our own indiscretions, but there's a major responsibility for how we treat other people. And how we treat other people is significant today. How we treat other people is in no way someplace we can bow out of today. How we treat other people impacts our life and impacts where we will go in life.